Hi everyone, welcome back. I'm Chris, and today we're delving into Chapter 9 of F. Scott Fitzgerald's The Great Gatsby. Chapter 9 opens with, "After 2 years, I remembered the rest of that day, and that night, and the next day, only as an endless drill of police and photographers and newspaper men in and out of Gatsby's front door." The novel's events take place in the summer of 1922, but Nick is narrating them from 1924. In Chapter 8, Gatsby's mansion was empty the night before his death. He and Nick had wandered around almost in a daze, searching for cigarettes. Gatsby concerned about Daisy's well-being. Nick trying to process Myrtle's death and all of the crazy things that had happened. The sun rose and Gatsby's mansion remained empty, except for some servants. Gatsby's final moments were spent alone, floating in his pool, before George, another solitary figure, a man with no children and seemingly no friends, murdered Gatsby. Now, Gatsby's mansion is full again, but not with party guests. It's police and reporters. During the investigation, Mikey Ellis did mention that George questioned the fidelity of his wife, Myrtle, but Myrtle's sister, Catherine, did not corroborate this. Instead, Catherine looked at the coroner with determined eyes under that corrected brow of hers and swore that her sister had never seen Gatsby, that her sister was completely happy with her husband, that her sister had been into no mischief. She convinced herself of it and cried into her handkerchief as if the very suggestion was more than she could endure. Interestingly, when Nick talks about Catherine's testimony, Nick says she showed a surprising amount of character about it too. This causes us as the reader to question, why is Nick complimenting Catherine lying? Remember, in Chapter 2, Nick attended a party at Tom and Myrtle's love nest in the city, and Catherine was there too. And Catherine told Nick how both Myrtle and Tom could not stand the people they were married to, and Myrtle wanted to marry Tom. So Catherine is well aware of the situation. The police conclude the investigation by declaring that George was deranged by grief, a madman. Nothing more to say. People used to flock like moths to Gatsby's luminous parties, but now it's just Nick. The responsibility for planning the funeral falls onto Nick. There doesn't appear to be any family or friends for Gatsby. When Nick calls the Buchanan Mansion, he learns that Tom and Daisy are gone. Destination, unknown. Return date, unknown. We can now include East Egg with Santa Barbara and Chicago in the list of places Tom and Daisy have fled to avoid scandal. What happens to Tom and Daisy? Do they leave East Egg permanently? In Chapter 1, Nick did say, "Why they came east, I don't know. They had spent a year in France for no particular reason, and then drifted here and there unrestfully, wherever people played polo and were rich together." Daisy had said it was a permanent move, and Tom declared, "I'd be a goddamn fool to live anywhere else." What is their fate? We don't know. It's up to our imagination. The Great Gatsby's copyright did expire on January 1st, 2021, so maybe someone will publish a sequel that follows up on Tom and Daisy. Nick in the mansion with Gatsby's corpse becomes panicked because he can't find anyone with a personal connection to Gatsby. Nick had only met Gatsby a few months ago, and they had only hung out a few times. Nick wants to reassure Gatsby, "I'll get somebody for you, Gatsby. Don't worry. Just trust me, and I'll get somebody for you." Nick calls Wolsheim's office, but no one picks up. Nick imagines Gatsby saying, "Will you ring again? I've rung them 3 times. It's very important. Sorry, I'm afraid no one's there." "Look here, old sport. You've got to get somebody for me. You've got to try hard. I can't go through this alone." Nick sends a letter to Wolfsheim, and Wolfsheim responds, "I cannot come down now, as I am tied up in some very important business and cannot get mixed up in this thing now. If there is anything I can do a little later, let me know in a letter by Edgar. I hardly know where I am when I hear about a thing like this and am completely knocked down and out. Yours truly, Wolfsheim." Nick narrates, "I began to have a feeling of defiance, of scornful solidarity between Gatsby and me against them all." While Nick is upset with Gatsby's reaction to Myrtle's death, and he does not condone Gatsby's bootlegging, everyone else's indifference towards Gatsby's death causes Nick to feel responsible for Gatsby, to feel a bond with Gatsby. Remember, in the opening pages of the novel, Nick said, "No, Gatsby turned out all right at the end. It is what preyed on Gatsby, what foul dust floated in the wake of his dreams, that temporarily closed out my interest in the abortive sorrows and short-winded elations of men." It's Gatsby's environment, Gatsby's weaknesses, what preys on Gatsby that Nick is disgusted by. It's not Gatsby himself. As a man, Gatsby is great. He's optimistic, he's hopeful, and Nick respects Gatsby's inner dream and his pursuit and his incorruptible heart. 3 days after Gatsby's death, Nick receives a telegram from Henry C. Gatz from Minnesota. It said to postpone the funeral until his arrival. It is Gatsby's father who read about the death in the Chicago newspaper. When Gatz arrives, he is visibly grieving the loss of his son, but also admiring Gatsby's mansion and is proud of Gatsby's accomplishments. You see, Gatz thought his son legitimately earned his wealth, and that if he lived longer, he would have helped build up the country like James J. Hill, a real-life railroad executive known as the Empire Builder. Nick does not shatter Gatz's illusion. He does not reveal the truth about Gatsby's wealth. He also expresses solidarity and calls Gatsby his close friend. That night, the phone rings at Gatsby's mansion. It's Klipspringer, the piano player from Chapter 5. Nick invites Klipspringer to the funeral, but Klipspringer is really evasive about attending. Turns out, he was just calling to get his tennis shoes back. The morning of the funeral, Nick goes into New York City to see Wolsheim. The secretary pretends Wolsheim isn't in, but Nick can hear his voice. When Nick mentions Gatsby's name, the secretary goes and gets Wolsheim. We learn Wolsheim was Gatsby's mentor in organized crime. Wolsheim reflects on the first time he met Gatsby. "A young major just out of the army and covered over with medals he got in the war. He was so hard up he had to keep on wearing his uniform because he couldn't buy some regular clothes. First time I saw him was when he come into Weinbrenner's pool room at 43rd Street and asked for a job." Wolsheim knew Gatsby would be an asset because he was handsome, well-mannered, and Oxford educated. Wolsheim says he would like to attend the funeral, but, "When a man gets killed, I never like to get mixed up in it in any way. I keep out. Let us learn to show our friendship for a man when he is alive and not after he is dead." It begins to drizzle. Nick arrives back in West Egg. Mr. Gatz is admiring Gatsby's possessions. He shows Nick a worn photograph of the mansion, implying that he has shown it to many people over the years. 2 years ago, Gatsby visited his father and bought him a house. This helped Gatz understand why his son had run away from home. His son had been moving towards a brighter future. Gatz takes out an old copy of a book called Hopalong Cassidy. On the inside cover, a young Gatsby had written his daily schedule, which included things such as rising at 6 a.m., exercising, studying electricity, working. It also included some general resolves, such as stop wasting time, be better to parents. This is an allusion to the autobiography of Benjamin Franklin, and it reaches back to an older America when striving and hard work were the ideals. The funeral is about to start, it's raining, and Nick hears a car. He turns, and it's Owl Eyes. It pours during the ceremony. Gatsby, who had reached across the water towards Daisy and had died in water, is now buried in water. He metaphorically drowns, sinking further and further from the light until he rests in a dark abyss. Meanwhile, Daisy, the golden girl, she floats above it all and doesn't even bother to send flowers. After the service, Nick reveals that no one had paid their respects at the mansion. Owl Eyes, the one with glasses, the one who in Chapter 3 had perceived that Gatsby was projecting a well-crafted facade, what does he see now? "Why, my God, they used to go there by the hundreds." He took off his glasses and wiped them again, outside and in. The poor son of a bitch. Coincidentally, Fitzgerald's funeral mirrors Gatsby's. Both were held in the rain and sparsely attended. Fitzgerald's daughter, Scotty, recalled that the Protestant minister who had buried Fitzgerald said, "The only reason I agreed to give the service was to get the body in the ground. He was a no good, drunken bum, and the world was well rid of him." We now move into some of the most beautiful pages in all of American prose. Nick is filled with nostalgia as he recalls his schoolboy days, how during winter break, they would all travel home to celebrate Christmas. Nick narrates, "That's my Middle West, not the wheat or the prairies or the lost sweet towns, but the thrilling returning trains of my youth and the street lamps and sleigh bells in the frosty dark and the shadows of holly wreaths thrown by lighted windows on the snow. I am part of that, a little solemn with the feel of those long winters, a little complacent from growing up in the caraway house in a city where dwellings are still called through decades by a family's name. I see now that this has been a story of the West. After all, Tom and Gatsby, Daisy and Jordan, and I were all Westerners, and perhaps we possessed some deficiency in common, which made us subtly unadaptable to Eastern life." This passage is filled with motifs of homecoming and travel, how our identities are shaped by where we grew up, the people we were surrounded with, the values that were instilled in us. Nick fought it. Nick ran away from home. He moved to New York City. He wanted to be an independent man and be a successful bondsman. But we learn that Nick ultimately leaves New York City. He's disgusted by the East Coast morality, and he retreats back to the place, "That's my Middle West. I am part of that." It's where Nick belongs. Nick also realizes that most of the characters in the book were not originally from the East Coast. They are transplants who moved to New York City, who were drawn to it, whose lives are ultimately destroyed on the East Coast. Nick's narration continues, "Even when the East excited me most, even when I was most keenly aware of its superiority to the bored, sprawling, swollen towns beyond the Ohio, with their interminable inquisitions, which spared only the children and the very old, even then, it had always for me a quality of distortion. West Egg, especially, still figures in my more fantastic dreams. I see it as a night scene by El Greco, 100 houses at once conventional and grotesque, crouching under a sullen, overhanging sky and a lustreless moon. In the foreground, 4 solemn men in dress suits are walking along the sidewalk with a stretcher on which lies a drunken woman in a white evening dress. Her hand, which dangles over the side, sparkles cold with jewels. Gravely, the men turn in at a house, the wrong house, but no one knows the woman's name, and no one cares." This passage reveals why Nick leaves New York City. Yes, the East is exciting. New York City has more going on than the Midwest, but it has a quality of distortion. Distortion means giving a false impression. Nick alludes to the Greek-Spanish artist El Greco, who worked in the 16th century, and he was known for a very dramatic and expressionistic style. And so this is how Nick remembers West Egg. It's very dark, gloomy. It has a quality of distortion. Things are not what they seem. And he talks about this drunken woman. These men are trying to get her home, but they don't even know her name or where she lives. Nick feels the East Coast is this glitz and glamour facade. But beyond that facade, if you look deeper, there's nothing there. There's a hollowness, an emptiness, a lack of community. Nick decides he doesn't want to be a part of that. He wants to return back to the Midwest, to a more humble, practical location where his family lives, where he has those connections. Before Nick leaves New York City, he decides there's one thing he has to do: officially end things with Jordan Baker. Nick goes to see Jordan. When Nick walks into the room, Jordan is sitting there dressed to play golf, and Nick says that Jordan looked like a good illustration. It's like Jordan is consciously posing herself. She wants to project a certain image to Nick. After Nick finishes his spiel, Jordan doesn't really say anything about the breakup. She simply says that she was engaged to another man. Nick kind of questions whether Jordan is telling the truth, but it doesn't really matter. The point is, Jordan was controlling her emotions and posing because she didn't want Nick to win. She didn't want Nick to feel like his actions and words affected her. Then Jordan references that conversation she and Nick had in chapter 3 about bad drivers. Jordan says, "You said a bad driver was only safe until she met another bad driver. Well, I met another bad driver, didn't I? I mean, it was careless of me to make such a wrong guess. I thought you were rather an honest, straightforward person. I thought it was your secret pride. Jordan is calling out Nick. Jordan is comparing their relationship to a crash. Jordan thought Nick was gonna be really careful and steady, but instead she accuses Nick of being dishonest. Now we as readers, we could go back through the entire novel and think more about how everything was told to us through Nick's perception. It is his first person point of view. Is Nick a reliable narrator? What has Nick omitted? Has he painted himself in a more positive light than he was in reality? Is he really a non-judgmental person? What does Jordan know? What has Jordan seen that prompted her to make this declaration? We will never know because the novel's from Nick's point of view. So all we can do is go back through and look at the clues. For example, earlier in chapter 9, Nick was praising Catherine lying during the investigation of Myrtle's death. Nick defends himself to Jordan and says, "I'm 30. I'm 5 years too old to lie to myself and call it honor." Jordan doesn't respond because she is so over this situation, and then Nick says he is still angry with Jordan, but half in love with her, and leaves. Nick is half in love with everyone. Remember, in chapter 1, he ran away from a girl back home because people were gossiping that they were going to get married, and then he continued in the earlier chapters to write love letters to that girl, and then when he decides to officially pursue a relationship with Jordan Baker, he has to officially end that relationship back home. And then here he's decided that he's just, you know, so disgusted with Jordan and how Jordan behaved after Myrtle's death, and so he's going to break up with Jordan and run away from her. For me, it goes back to Nick's characterization in chapter 1 and how he calls himself a restless person. Nick doesn't know what he wants, and that's why he's angry but half in love with Jordan. He's playing games, and Nick wants to see himself as the hero, as the person that's too old to lie to himself. He's too old to play games. He's the honorable, non-judgmental person. And then Tom Buchanan reappears. One afternoon late in October, so Nick is still in New York City, this is before his departure, Nick is walking along Fifth Avenue and he sees Tom Buchanan. Nick tries to avoid Tom, but Tom approaches Nick and holds out his hand. Nick won't shake it. Tom says, "What's the matter, Nick? Do you object to shaking hands with me?" "Yes, you know what I think of you." "You're crazy, Nick. Crazy as hell. I don't know what's the matter with you." "Tom, what did you say to Wilson that afternoon?" "I told him the truth. He came to the door while we were getting ready to leave, and when I sent down word that we weren't in, he tried to force his way upstairs. He was crazy enough to kill me if I hadn't told him who owned the car. His hand was on a revolver in his pocket every minute he was in the house. What if I did tell him? That fella had it coming to him. He threw dust into your eyes, just like he did Daisy's, but he was a tough one. He ran over Myrtle like you'd run over a dog and never even stopped his car." To throw dust into someone's eyes means you distort their vision, cast them under a magical spell. Tom is saying that Gatsby's magnetic charisma manipulated Nick and Daisy. Nick and Daisy did not see the true Gatsby, but Tom did. Tom understood that Gatsby was a bootlegger, a criminal. That detail about Gatsby running over Myrtle, we know it was Daisy. So has Daisy lied to Tom? Or does Tom know the truth, and because this is a public setting, he's never going to admit the truth because he wants to protect his family? Gatsby is dead, might as well make Gatsby the scapegoat because the dead don't talk, and he and his family can just escape all consequences. Nick offers this final assessment of the Buchanans. "I couldn't forgive him or like him, but I saw that what he had done was, to him, entirely justified. It was all very careless and confused. They were careless people, Tom and Daisy. They smashed up things and creatures and then retreated back into their money or their vast carelessness or whatever it was that kept them together and let other people clean up the mess they had made." Notice the word choice in this passage. It is not people that are affected by Tom and Daisy, but things and creatures. This passage gives us an insight into the minds of Tom and Daisy and how wealth separates them from other people. Wealth allows them to escape consequences. They don't have to clean up their mess. They don't even really consider the humanity behind the people they are destroying. On the final page of the novel, it is Nick's last night in New York. He walks over to Gatsby's yard, and Nick imagines what Long Island would have looked like when the first European settlers arrived. Nick says, "And as the moon rose higher, the inessential houses began to melt away until gradually I became aware of the old island here that flowered once for Dutch sailors' eyes, a fresh green breast of the new world." These European explorers are coming from a continent where all of the land had been claimed by kings. There was nothing new left to discover. They were sailing across the Atlantic Ocean, hoping to find a passage to China, and instead, they ran into an entire continent. The presence of that continent, the possibilities it could offer, it sparked the explorers' capacity for wonder. The North American continent represented a canvas, a blank slate in which people could use their imaginations to build something. Gatsby was the same way. His life was a blank slate. He didn't like where he came from. He wasn't known for anything. And so he decided to change his life, to create a masterpiece that he would be proud of. And Daisy was his muse, his inspiration. There's a problem though. Nick narrates about Gatsby. He had come a long way to this blue lawn, and his dream must have seemed so close that he could hardly fail to grasp it. He did not know that it was already behind him, somewhere back in that vast obscurity beyond the city, where the dark fields of the Republic rolled on under the night. Gatsby worked so hard, but he doesn't realize the dream ended 5 years ago in Louisville. Daisy moved on. You can't freeze time. You can't repeat the past. Daisy today in 1922 is not the same woman when Gatsby met her in 1917. Remember the green light. In chapter one, it's at the end of Daisy's dock and Gatsby is reaching for it. It symbolizes his pursuit of her. Later in chapter five, after they're reunited, Gatsby realizes the green light no longer means anything because Daisy is standing right next to him. Now in the final page, Nick mentions the green light again. Gatsby believed in the green light, the orgastic future that year by year recedes before us. It eluded us then, but that's no matter. Tomorrow, we will run faster, stretch out our arms farther, and one fine morning, so we beat on, boats against the current, borne back ceaselessly into the past. You can interpret these lines pessimistically or optimistically. Today, I choose to be an optimist. Nick is saying the green light no longer means anything to Gatsby because Gatsby is dead. Instead, now, that green light is connected to you, the reader, your future. Tomorrow, you will wake up. And you will continue to make progress towards your goals. You will run faster. You will stretch out your arms. The water is going to push against you. It's going to be difficult. There are going to be obstacles in the way, but you will beat against the current. You will row your boat. You will do whatever it takes to accomplish your dreams. You have a little bit of Jay Gatsby within you. I waited for it, that green light. Cause on the aisle, come get my things, but I can't let go. I waited for it, that green light. Oh, I always try, could get my things and just let go. I waited for it, that green light. I want it. And that concludes the novel. If you have joined me since the beginning, thank you. It has been an honor to share one of my favorite novels with you. If you found this video helpful, please hit the like button so that other people can discover it. I wish you much happiness in life as you pursue your green light. But I hear sounds in my mind. Brand new sounds.